America is essentially a dream.
Good evening, and welcome to the first anniversary show of Network X. I'm your host, Bill Brignoli. I'm pretty excited about being on the first anniversary show here. And we're pleased to have with us in the TCI studios tonight, on my left, John Gershman. John is a research associate at the Institute for Food and Development Policy, better known as Food First. A PhD student in political science at the University of California at Berkeley, John is also co-editor of Trading Freedom, How Free Trade Affects Our Lives, Our Work, and Environment. He's currently researching popular movements and alternatives to neoliberal development in Latin America and Southeast Asia. His research includes the effects of the World Bank and the IMF, and he works with the 50 Years is Enough campaign, a national campaign of development and environmental organizations working to transform the bank and the fund.
Thanks for having me, Bill.
To his left is Larry Dohrs. Larry is an MA in Southeast Asian Studies from the University of Michigan, past editor for the Journal of Southeast Asia Business, and coordinator of the Seattle Burma Interest Group, a nonpartisan monthly information forum. Larry is also coordinator of a Seattle campaign for a Free Burma, an activist group working for democracy and justice in Burma. He is a panelist at the upcoming conference at the University of Washington entitled Southeast Asia and the New Economic Order in November. Well, gentlemen, welcome to our program.
Well, thanks for having us.
John, why don't you start it off and tell us a little bit about the 50 Years is Enough campaign, your involvement, and perhaps the involvement of your institute.
Sure. This year, 1994, is the 50th anniversary of the Bretton Woods Conference, which was held in Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, 1944, just before the end of World War II. And at that conference was laid the foundation for the post-war international economic order. And two of the most important events were the founding, or the basis for the creation of the World Bank and the IMF, the International Monetary Fund. And these two institutions have come to play a very critical role in shaping the economies of particularly countries, Latin America and Africa, and also in Southeast Asia. And we have a group of, at this point, over 200 development and environmental organizations in the United States, have been working with over 100 groups, partly in Europe, Africa, Southeast Asia, Latin America, to try and effect fundamental transformations in the policies and institutions of the bank and the IMF.
Is this the first attempt to do that?
Well, what this actually represents is the first coordinated attempt. For the last 20 years, environment groups, development groups have been working to try and change the bank simply by themselves, working on a particular project, say criticizing a road building project in the Brazilian Amazon, for example, or groups who are concerned about Nicaragua criticizing the economic adjustment policies of the World Bank. Mm-hmm. But this campaign represents for the first time the coming together of health activists, environmentalists, church people, labor, as well as development and environment people, to present a common agenda for change and to demand that these institutions become more accountable, demand that they pursue policies that promote equitable, sustainable, and participatory development. And if they fail to do that, if they prove themselves incapable of doing that, then that they need to be shut down.
So it sounds like it's the most organized effort, I would say, in a nutshell.
We would like to think so, yes.
But as Larry knows with the work he does around Burma, you can never be too organized. Larry, why don't you speak to us a little bit about both of those groups? The first one is the Forum.
Yeah, the Burma Interest Group here in Seattle is about a year old. It includes about 40 members. We meet on a monthly basis here in Seattle. Our next meeting is November 3rd. The focus of the group is as an informational forum, simply to allow people from all perspectives to share the latest information on Burma. One of the things that is unfortunately the case here in the U.S. is that you get very little information about some of the developing countries, Burma among the most difficult to get information on. So we have this monthly meeting. The information comes from all over the world, and we get it together here.
What are some of your sources of that information?
Well, a lot comes from the internet. A lot comes from Thai newspapers, from Burmese dissident groups. We're getting stuff from the Burma Action Group in London. They develop a lot of material. It just comes from the Burmese community in the U.S., all different places, and that's why it's important to kind of bring people together to share that stuff, because it doesn't come from one particular source.
What sort of interest have you found amongst Seattleites?
Well, I'm pleased to say that we found a lot of interest. It is characteristic of people who have studied or visited Burma, that they develop something of a passionate interest that goes back to Rudyard Kipling and even before. So we have a lot of very passionately interested people. It's not like we're a major part of the community, but it's just good to bring people together who have this common interest.
It seems that, from what I understand of both of your organizations, that you both deal with, some, you might say, the negative impacts of economic development, or perhaps the wrong kind of economic development. I think, John, you stated it as economic development without any accountability. Why don't you speak to one project you're the most familiar with? I think you mentioned Brazil.
The institute that I work with, Food First, our major role is in relationship to the 50 Years is Enough campaign is research and education. And one of the communities that we've done work with are people who are interested in promoting sustainable development in the Amazon. One of the challenges clearly has been how can local communities who depend upon the forest for their survival and existence, how can they actually control what happens to these resources. One of the problems is that both the Brazilian government and the World Bank have a different vision of what development is about. They think that what development should be about is building large roads, promoting massive industrialization, and one of the things that's happening is that they have supported a project called the Polonareste Project, which is building a huge road to support ranching and soybean production in the Amazon. And it's resulted in massive deforestation. It's also resulted in facilitated massive migration from other parts, from the northeast of Brazil in particular, that have brought people into Indian lands and into lands that the rubber tappers have worked historically as sustainable extractivists, people who depend upon the continued existence of the forest. And it was this project in particular that, for example, Chico Mendes was actively involved in, and it represented a broader set of struggles about who gets to determine who uses the resources of the forest.
Larry, isn't there an indigenous group that's threatened by a project that one of your groups is working on right now? The UNICAL project?
Yes, in fact, there are a couple of indigenous groups who are threatened by this pipeline project. It's a natural gas pipeline taking natural gas that's been discovered in the Andaman Sea in southern Burma across the mountains to Thailand, where they have a lot of natural gas processing facilities. The ethnic group most at risk is the Mon group, and they were the first Buddhists in Southeast Asia. They were there well before either the Burmans or the Thais arrived. There have been some very severe cases of forced labor where they've gone and taken many villagers, forcibly removed the villagers, destroyed the villages, and forced the villagers to work on projects that are related to this pipeline, most specifically a rail line between the towns of Ye and Tavoy in Burma. The pipeline project that UNOCAL and Texaco are involved with bisects exactly this rail line, and perhaps disingenuously, I don't really know, UNOCAL claims that that it has no interest whatsoever in this rail line, although it seems difficult to believe since they're about to bisect it with another substantial infrastructure project, that being a road connected to a natural gas pipeline running up through the mountains. It's the pressure on the Hmong people also coming from the Thai military, which is involved in this gas project because the gas is going to benefit Thailand. They'll make some profit off of it. Mm-hmm. The pressure is really, really severe. Right at this moment, the refugees...
What sort of pressure?
Well, they've forced refugees who have tried to flee from Burmese army attacks. They forced them back across the border. They forced them in several ways, but they cut off food supplies, cut off water supplies.
To the whole region?
To the area where 6,000 refugees have been literally squatting. I've seen photographs from the area, and they have nothing more than some bamboo sticks and pieces of plastic to protect them from the elements.
Well, in a sense, it almost sounds like the same economic policies that have been practiced in our country, you know, in the last 15 years, only not quite to the extreme, or I should say to a greater extreme. But, we've been, it seems, engaged in this quote-unquote neoliberal, you know, economic policy. I think here they called it Reaganomics, where basically, you know, it seems that assets or community resources have been... privatized, and then we have the only thing getting nationalized are the debt. It seems in the case of the third world, the only thing getting nationalized is the suffering. Although I think in some instances, if I'm correct, some of these projects basically are so badly designed. They basically provide virtually no economic benefit except for maybe a very, very small part of the population. Mm-hmm. And eventually, if and when they do fail, then the debt, which is massive, then has to become nationalized. Mm-hmm. Am I correct in assuming that?
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. I guess the one thing is that there are always a group of people who benefit from the project side of what the World Bank does, and those are the contractors who build the dams and build the roads and build those kinds of things. In fact, the bank itself recently had a report, the Wapenhans report, which revealed that the bank, if you look at a sample of the bank's projects, only 35% of the projects could be considered successful. That's a pretty serious problem for an institution that's involved with, you know, spending $25 billion a year.
And how would they gauge success?
Well, what they did is they looked at what the objectives or targets were for the project, whether they were supposed to, you know, build a dam, and whether, for example, if the dam is supposed to provide electricity or hydroelectric power, that it actually provides that. One thing it doesn't do, for example, is determine whether or not it's only providing the electricity to a large iron refinery or iron plant, and not to the communities that were displaced by the dam itself. This is happened, in fact, in Brazil, where they built a large dam. The people were not provided any funds to resettle, so they still live right around the reservoir of the dam. The dam is now the source of large amount of waterborne diseases, schistosomiasis and others, which these people now suffer from. And the only people who got the electricity from the dam were a number of companies that are involved in iron smelting and other metal processing. And the people who built the dam, of course, made lots of money. The people of Brazil have to pay for it now, and the problem, of course, is that the majority of people of Brazil, even the majority of the people in that particular region, didn't benefit from it.
You know, I would almost see where this kind of projects, or the ability to force something like this upon a nation, almost requires the kind of political environment that came down in Burma.
Well, it...
Or certainly, should we say encourages it, or makes... I would say makes it possible.
Well, it that could certainly be argued. In the case of Burma, the government has stayed in power. It's a military government. It stayed in power despite losing elections that were held in 1990 overwhelmingly. A single opposition party won over 80% of the vote. The military party won approximately 3% of the vote. So there's no question but that a very small clique mm-hmm. are making the decisions in the case of Burma. And of course it's true in a country like Brazil traditionally, although they're moving toward more democracy apparently. But it does seem like a situation like Burma's typically is ripe for mm-hmm. Some really misguided projects where a lot of money just simply gets funneled off to the ruling clique.
It almost seems, in a sense, then the bank, in a sense, has itself covered, because it is dealing with some people that are going to benefit, but because of perhaps the political climate in mm-hmm. the country, it's not dealing with the people who are
right.
going to suffer the adverse impacts.
No, absolutely. I mean, the bank technically.
So that accountability element is in a very small element there.
Right.
But how is the campaign working to just expand mm-hmm. accountability, or does it have a broader plan?
Well, we have a broader plan. We have a long set of demands, which I can be happy to send any of our viewers or send you if anyone's interested. But they boil down to basically three or four kind of main points or issues. First is that the bank has to stop promoting policies that are not determined by the people who are going to be affected by them. So in the context, for example, of a large development project, the bank actually has very wonderfully elaborate operational guidelines as to what do you do if you're going to promote an infrastructure project, who you have to speak to, what kind of environmental and social impact assessments you have to do.
The thing is, suggesting they're not followed.
They don't do them. And so what we're saying is, at a minimum, follow the policies that you already have.
For a start.
Just for a start. Secondly, if you're going to involve in a project that's going to result in displacing people, that has to be written in to the amount of money, and that money has to get to the people who are affected. And if it doesn't, then the bank has to do something about that in terms of halting its funding for the project, in terms of mandating that the people affected actually benefit from the project. And that the projects themselves, you know, these large mega projects like dams, road building and so forth, really have to be rethought. Are those the kinds of projects that are the most important to promote development? If we start asking people on the ground what they would like, very often we get very different answers. They would like clean water, they would like schools, they would like health clinics that offer community-based health care. They would like a number of other things which may not require as much money, actually involve the participation of the community much more, and are actually going to have much more significant results on a broader set of people. Mm-hmm. So the first thing is participation of communities affected. Secondly, is that the bank has to get out of what's called policy lending, out of structural adjustment loans, loans that are primarily targeted at rapidly integrating economies into the world market, and instead spend more money on grassroots projects that actually create, democratize purchasing power within countries. That if we think democracy is such a good thing in the political realm, then I wonder why we don't think it's a good thing in the economic realm. More people with more purchasing power would be a good thing. The third component is really taking the ecological and social costs of development seriously. And if we're going to do that, that would probably mitigate against a large number of bank projects that are currently approved, and that we would like to really move away from that kind of lending.
Larry, are there any IMF or World Bank funds going to this project, this gas pipeline project in Thailand?
In fact, there are not, and that's one thing that I have to say positively about United States policy. The U.S. is a leader in holding firm against the regime, the military regime in Burma. That means that World Bank funds are not available Nonetheless, private financing through these companies is what is doing the job. It's important to note, though, that John has been talking about some of the dam projects. Thailand has proposed a number of dam projects along the Salwan River, which in some areas forms the border between Thailand and Burma. And they are looking for Asian Development Bank and World Bank funding for those projects. And in, again, the people displaced would be the indigenous peoples who are the victims already of the Burmese army. And it, so it would be a really unfortunate situation, as the political structures are right now, to finance projects like that.
Hasn't that been the tale that history has always told? The indigenous population falls by the wayside. Well, with regard to accountability, though, Larry, how do we know that those corporations aren't getting World Bank funds through their other subsidiaries or somehow through third-party financing? Is there a level of accountability? Does it go that far?
It's a good question, and it's not one that I'm able to answer right now.
Are those the kind of questions
as the Seattle Campaign for Free Burma are trying to emphasize, just as you say, accountability. Mm-hmm. And if there are only a small number of U.S. companies doing business in Burma, I'm happy to report that this week one of them, Liz Claiborne, the $2 billion a year garment manufacturer, has announced that it will no longer do business in Burma. Levi Strauss, a little while ago, also, because of its own corporate standards of conduct, refused to do business in Burma and left after they were there already. Unfortunately, here in Seattle, again, when it comes to accountability, a local company, Eddie Bauer Inc., which is a $1.25 billion a year company, continues to do business in Burma using factories which it does not own, but are 50% owned by a Hong Kong company and 50% owned by Burmese money, which has military connections.
Is there any local effort being, any local
yes,
pressure being placed against Eddie Bauer?
A regional group called a boycott of Eddie Bauer products. We give out their 800 number. Many hundreds of calls have been logged at Eddie Bauer. We feel with Liz Claiborne, which is a larger company making the decision to leave, that now the pressure is really on Eddie Bauer. They've got to make the decision. Do they want to do business in a country where there is no law against forced labor, there's no law against child labor, there's only a law against organized labor?
Before we forget, actually, maybe we should do it now. Why don't we have both of you talk about the contacts that you have for people who do want to get involved. John?
Sure. If people are interested in finding out more about the 50 Years is Enough campaign, they can contact me at the Institute for Food and Development Policy. The address is 398 60th Street. That's in Oakland, California, 94618. Or they can call at area code 510-654-4400.
And Larry, locally?
Yes, locally here in Seattle, they can call my group at the number 206-784-6873. We do meet on a monthly basis. Our next meeting is November 3rd. Again, if anybody gives me a call, I can also provide numbers of corporations or in other cities, different groups. There's a network of groups across the U.S. and really worldwide. Again, thank goodness for the internet. It allows us to communicate, and it has really strengthened the groups working together in separate places all over the world.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. You know, one of you just mentioned dam projects. I know right now China is planning the Three Valleys?
Three Gorges
yeah. project. Right. Which apparently is gonna displace 1 million people?
1.3 million
people. And apparently take up some of the best agricultural land that the nation has. It's amazing. If you want to think of a misguided policy, there is a nation of how many people?
1.2 billion
people actually destroying or flooding some of its best agricultural land. Do either of you know specifically about that project, whether it is an IMF project and how far along it is?
It's not an IMF project. So far, the bank is waffling on whether or not it's going to actually fund it. It seems, though, that the Chinese government is fairly committed to funding it and pursuing it. They have jailed journalists and others who have written critically about the project. Mm-hmm. But if people want to get in, if people want to get in touch with me, I can put them in touch with the International Rivers Network, which is leading in the U.S. Part of the campaign against the project.
And Larry, with regard to that pipeline project, do you have any special pressure you're trying to work on? Are you working on the corporations themselves? Are you working through the State Department? What's the plan?
Well, there are a couple of members of Congress. Tom Lantos is one, and he has brought UNICAL on the carpet a couple of times in a human rights subcommittee.
What state is he? Is he a representative or a senator?
He is a representative.
From California.
From California. And he has a hardworking staff. In Congress, it's bipartisan. The pressure comes from, I have a letter that was sent to Warren Christopher asking for increased pressure on Burma that was signed, the two signatures next to each other, one is Jesse Helms and the other is Ted Kennedy. It's not a partisan issue. It's really more a question of information. If people come to learn a little bit more about exactly what's going on there, they end up on the side that both Jesse Helms and Ted Kennedy are on.
Well, thank you, John. Thank you, Larry.
Thanks very much, Bill.
That's what we're about here on Network X, keeping people informed so that they can get involved. We thank you for joining us this evening in our first anniversary show of Network X. And as your host, Bill Brignoli, I bid you good night, and I also bid you to stay informed and get involved. Have a good night.
Great.